everyone, and welcome to a very special Dawn of the Dead episode of the Atheist Experience. I am your host, Russell Glasser, and with me today is my co-host, Jeff D. How are you, Jeff?
I'm doing well, Russell. Thank you.
That's right. According to tradition, on this very day, exactly 1,975 years ago, 3 days after a man had died, he rose from his grave and then shambled forth back into the land of the living. And ever since then, he has been trying to convince people to eat his flesh and drink his blood so that they could ultimately become like him. And as you can see down here, or you can if they put the camera on it, we've got several trappings of the holiday right here on the desk. We've got, well, you can't see that very well, but we've got some bunnies and we've got some fake grass here. And down
in honor of this zombie. Though that's right. I think it's maybe not fair to characterize that as a zombie because zombies are the opposite. Zombies want to eat your flesh to turn you into them.
Well, that's true. So we've got these things, and also down below the desk where you can't see them, we have some automatic shotguns, some M16 rifles, and plenty of pipe bombs, because you never can be too careful.
That's for the zombies.
For the zombies, yes. Hey, everybody. It's a beautiful day here in Austin, Texas. It is Sunday, April 12th, 2009, and we are the Atheist Experience. We are a live public call-in show offering you people in and out of Austin the opportunity to interact with horrible blasphemers like us. The Atheist Experience is sponsored by the 100% zombie-free organization, the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. You can find out more by visiting www.atheist-community.org, and when you do, be sure to check out our Frequently Asked Questions page for answers to all your zombie-related needs. This show is live on Austin Public Access Channel 16 every Sunday from 4:30 to 6 o'clock p.m. Central Time. And if you're not in Austin, you can still watch the show live as it happens by visiting the official Atheist Experience website, www.atheist-experience.com, and clicking on Live Stream at the top of the page. And if you are local to Austin, you should still visit the live stream so that you can get involved with our fine, wonderful chat room and the many intelligent people who also watch this show. Also on the website, you will find audio and video clips from our past episodes. If you click on Archive, you will find a complete list of every program that we've ever done, and the more recent ones all have links to audio and video that you can click on. And there's also a fan page where you can visit YouTube so that you can see all the clips that that some of our fans selected as examples of our best work. The Atheist Community of Austin has weekly meetings at Romeo's on Barton Springs Road every Sunday from 11:30 to 1 o'clock. Every Sunday except for the first Sunday of the month when we host our lecture series at the Austin History Center located at the corner of 9th and Guadalupe. However, next month, on May 3rd, there will be no lecture. Instead, members will meet to elect the next ACA Board of Directors. If you can't make it to the morning meetings, we encourage you to join us for dinner right after this program. We usually get to Threadgill's around 6:30 every Sunday, so that's a chance for you to meet all of the other people who work hard to put this show on. That's Threadgill's in South Austin. The address is 301 West Riverside Drive, and it's near Barton Springs Road. As always, we encourage all atheists and atheist-friendly people to come and join us for dinner after the show. However, as always, we ask that you not come if your only intention is to preach, proselytize, provoke, or eat our flesh. Remember, we have pipe bombs. As if our regular meetings, meals, lectures, television programs, and podcasts weren't enough, the ACA also hosts an Atheist Happy Hour every Thursday, beginning at around 7 p.m. at the Dog and Duck Pub, located at the corner of 17th and Guadalupe. And in addition to this show, the ACA also sponsors a bi-weekly internet audio podcast called The Nonprofits. Visit www.nonprofitsradio.com, that's P-R-O-P-H-E-T-S, for more information. There was no show on this week, and actually there wasn't a regular show on last week. Life got in the way of most of us, but there, if everything goes well, then there should be one on next week. So that's when you can hear it. If you'd like to get in touch with us, but you don't feel like calling in today, you can email us at tv@atheist-community.org. And a fair warning, we get far more calls on this show than we can process, and we give special priority to people who are either in Austin or want to argue with us. So if you just want to say you're a fan of the show, then save it for email, or you can try to call in after the show when you can still see us on the live stream. I've got one special announcement, which is that there is an upcoming debate, in theory. We're not actually sure if what all the details are yet, but we have a URL for you to go to. The debaters are going to be Dr. Michael Shermer and Dr. Sahotra Sarkar on one side, versus Dr. Hugh Ross and Dr. actually a bunch of people. Well, Hugh Ross and some other people whose names I don't recognize on the other side.
We've heard that Dr. Sarkar has backed out.
Oh, okay.
But the problem is that the details of this have been changing. Why don't you give the URL?
Okay. So the topic of the debate is, was Darwin wrong? And the URL, we've made it a tiny URL. It's tinyurl.com/DLELMA.
Dilemma.
Dilemma. That's right. So I believe that's all for the announcements, except that in honor of this day, I would like to begin with to kick off the show with a somber reading from the Book of Brains. That's chapter 17, verse 3. And I quote, "And the Lord went unto them and did say, brains, brains, brains." Who isn't moved by that?
Russell.
Jeff?
You know, this is, in addition to this being a holiday in certain current and also ancient religions.
Yes.
Did you see this is also episode 600?
It's a big,
it's a big round number.
It is a round number. And
there
that's
are certain
significant
people who think that
because
kind of things.
We have 10 fingers.
Yeah. That's 2 times 300.
That's true. And you can factor it more into 2 times 3 times 5 times 5 times 2 times 2.
So in honor of this, do you mind if I jump in?
Yes.
You do? Okay, go ahead.
I mean, no. Go.
In honor of this holiday currently celebrated by Christians and previously celebrated by any number of ancient preceding religions, pagan religions, we thought it'd be fun to play a little game. So the game is going to be, we ask questions about the story of the resurrection, which is what this holiday is all about for Christians, and then callers get to consult their Bibles and call in and see if they can get it right. Let's just start this with this question. Now, in the Bible, according to the story, a group of women visit the tomb of Jesus, and the question is, when they arrived, was the tomb open or closed? Do, 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 do. And call in with your answers, and that will be a lot of fun. That's that.
That's it? We have to go straight to calls from there?
Well, then there's news. Do you want to do news for a while?
Sure, do some news.
Do you want me to do my news? I got kind of a little mini theme here. Apparently atheism is winning. Who would have guessed it? I mean, I've been with this organization for over 10 years, and boy, I can remember times when it was really pretty grim looking at the way our nation and the world were going, but there are some very encouraging signs. James Dobson recently delivered his farewell speech to the Focus on the Family staff and conceded that the culture war he helped start hasn't turned out well for the agents of intolerance. Indeed, Dobson almost sounded resigned to defeat.
Did he say he helped start it?
I believe that's a commentary by the author of this article.
Right. That doesn't sound very characteristic of Dobson. He would say, you know, they declared war on us.
Let's just move on.
Okay.
James Dobson, 72, who resigned recently as head of Focus on the Family, one of the largest Christian groups in the country, and who once denounced the Harry Potter books as witchcraft, didn't he also denounce the Teletubbies? Was that Dobson?
No, that was Jerry Falwell.
That was Falwell, okay.
The gay purple Teletubby with the triangle.
He acknowledged the dramatic reverse for the religious right in a farewell speech to his staff. Quote, "We tried to defend the unborn child, the dignity of the family, but it was a holding action," he said. "We are awash in evil, and the battle is still to be waged. We are right now in the most discouraging period of that long conflict. Humanly speaking, we can say we have lost all those battles." I would just like to make a comment here. He says they're trying to defend the unborn child. I would say, and I think a lot of other people would say, they were trying to force people to carry babies that they didn't want to have. Which is really none of their business. And this defending the dignity of the family is not in danger from liberal secular forces. It might be expanded to include other kinds of relationships, like gay relationships, that Mr. Dobson didn't want, but that wasn't going to hurt the dignity of the family. So he goes on to say that we are now awash in evil. Yeah, I was walking down the street the other day, and boy, I could just see evil things happening everywhere. Couldn't you?
Like what?
I don't know. however, Dobson also emphasized his desire to keep the fight going despite the religious rights setbacks. He says, "We can't say that we have lost all those battles, but God is in control, and we are not going to give up now, right? I have been assured by the board and by many of you that we are not going to cow, we're not going to be discouraged." That said, whether Dobson and his cohorts give up now or not, his assessment about their lack of success is nevertheless accurate. The culture war is all but over, and far-right evangelicals have precious little to show for their efforts. After about three decades of fighting, the culture warriors are hard-pressed to point to any progress at all. Anti-gay animus is not only waning, but four states now allow gay marriage. Abortion is still legal, and a majority of Americans are still pro-choice. School prayer isn't even on the political world's radar anymore. The single fastest-growing segment of the American spiritual landscape consists of non-believers and those with no religious identification. Okay. And if you don't want to take it from James Dobson, who, of course, is only, petty little leader, was the petty little leader of a segment of American Christians. Then there's the Pope. The Pope's Good Friday message warned of a drift into a desert of godlessness.
Oh, look, we happen to have one right here.
Here we are in the desert of godlessness.
It's actually kind of pretty.
And it's also kind of chilly. I wish they would turn the AC down a bit. Speaking during the Way of the Cross procession at the Colosseum in Rome, Pope Benedict the 16th said that religious sentiments were increasingly ranked among the unwelcome leftovers of antiquity and held up to scorn and ridicule. I agree. Check. He used this year's Good Friday meditations at the Stations of the Cross to compare attempts to purge religion from public life to the mockery Jesus Christ faced from the mob as he was led out to be crucified. Now, this is worthy of comment.
Yes.
Isn't it different? Isn't there a fundamental difference between saying, you know, it's all well and good for you people to believe whatever religious hoo-ha you want to believe, but we can't have you imposing your religious beliefs through legislation, right, on the one hand. And
reasonable.
Here's a guy they're hauling off to kill, and we're going to laugh at him and throw tomatoes and things. Aren't those fundamentally different? I would have thought so. The Bavarian-born pontiff, with his fantastic German accent, attacked efforts to secularize society, speaking at the seventh Station of the Cross, where Jesus is made an object of fun. I didn't know they had that.
Fun?
Jesus is apparently made an object of fun at the seventh Station of the Cross. It's a Catholic thing. I don't know what that means.
No, okay.
He said, quote, "We are shocked to see to what levels of brutality human beings can sink." This is not allowing them to pass legislation to impose their beliefs on others. That's the brutality.
Isn't their whole religion sort of based around, this one extremely brutal act and the sort of celebration of it?
They didn't like it.
Well, but but they shouldn't be shocked that it exists. I mean, every sermon I hear is about how humankind is all depraved, isn't it?
Yeah, I would say they shouldn't be shocked considering their own behavior off and on throughout history. But
that too.
He said, Jesus is humiliated in new ways even today. Now, that is true. There are some hilarious YouTube videos out there. When things that are most holy and profound in the faith are being trivialized, the sense of the sacred is allowed to erode. And I'm going to read into that particular comment that he's referring to things like the Eucharist cracker desecration thing.
Yes, P.Z. Myers of Feringula.
And just remind the audience and the Pope, if he's listening, that you people can hold your own things as sacred as you like. You've got no right to expect other people to hold them sacred as well. And that's not brutality, that's free choice. That's freedom of religion. Continuing, he said, everything in public life risks being desacralized. Persons, no more sacred persons. Are there more sacred persons that we're supposed to be worried about? Maybe he's referring to
what you mean.
Yeah, maybe he's referring to saints and things. Places. It's a risk that places won't be considered sacred anymore.
True.
Pledges, prayers, practices, words, sacred writings, religious formulae, symbols, and ceremonies. Once again, you can consider that stuff as sacred as you like, Mr. Pope. Our life together is being increasingly secularized. Religious life grows diffident. Thus, we see the most momentous matters placed among trifles and trivialities glorified. No. Taking a cracker and saying it's the flesh of your friend, your ancient dead raised and gone to heaven, and now he's vice god. Calling a cracker a piece of his flesh, that's glorifying a triviality. It's a cracker. But, hey, that's fine. Go right ahead. Just don't expect the rest of us to go along. We don't have to. Values and norms that held societies together and drew people to higher ideals are laughed at and thrown overboard. Jesus continues to be ridiculed. Well, okay. The reason why there are people laughing at and throwing overboard religious structures that were meant to hold society together is because we think they didn't do a very good job. We think they're not going to continue doing a very good job. We realize that the cost for embracing those religious structures to hold society together comes, the cost is we don't get to choose now whether we are going to hold your other beliefs sacred or not. So those things, those social structures that come from your religion, you're welcome to enjoy them within the bounds of your own flock. You just can't expect that the rest of us are going to join in. We're finding other ways to live together in peace. The Pope, who turns 82 later this month, prayed that Christians would respond to the problem by growing in faith. Okay. May we never question or mock things in life like a cynic, he prayed. Fine. You're free. Those people that have signed up for Catholicism are free to do as you say on that point if you want. All right.
You know what my favorite quote about cynicism is?
Sure. What?
Wish I had looked it up before opening my mouth. But it is pre-show
time.
Okay, I'm just going to have to do it from memory. George Bernard Shaw said, "The power of accurate observation is often called cynicism by those who have not got it."
That is a good point. The Pope's Good Friday message this year came after several high-profile British cases in which Christians have been reprimanded by their public sector employees for talking about their faith at work. Such developments led Dr. John Sentamu, the Archbishop of York, to proclaim in February that many Christians now, quote, have the daily challenge of living by a set of values that the world thinks are mad. We also think we have a reason to look at them that way. Last Sunday, Cardinal Cormac Murphy O'Connor also referred to the problem secularization posed to Christians in his final letter to Catholic congregations as the Archbishop of Westminster. He wrote, "We live in a very secular society that finds it difficult for people to hear and to experience the presence of God in their lives."
You know why it's difficult to hear and experience the presence of God in people's lives?
Why, Russell?
Because he doesn't exist.
That's what I would say. Okay.
That's
my news items. Atheism taken over, or at least elbowing religiosity aside.
Yeah. I've got one additional news story before we take our first caller. An example of the sort of evil that's proliferating in the world today. According to a Catholic archbishop, Britain has sold its soul to the pursuit of reason. The most Reverend Vincent Nichols, the Archbishop of Birmingham, claimed that because only provable facts are considered valuable, arguments based on morality and spirituality are ignored.
Ooh, may I comment?
Yes, you may.
There are arguments about morality that are based on proven facts. There are.
How about that?
Right? I mean, a good set of moral guidelines is going to be something you look at it and you say, why, you know, if we live by these, it will actually make life better. The morality that gets thrown aside, if you want it based on reason and evidence, are things that are just, you know, completely out of the blue pronouncements from a church or their supposed God saying you must not do X, when in fact that thing you're not supposed to do doesn't cause any harm whatsoever.
Right. To clarify, I'm not making light of this because we're all for the downfall of morality in society, as some would like to claim. It's just that we don't see faith as a virtue. We don't see throwing over so-called provable facts as the way that a society becomes more moral. Generally speaking, it is trying to figure out how best to get along in a society that actually winds up making things better.
Yeah, I'm reminded of the issue of... know, situational ethics. Mm-hmm. This, I haven't heard this argued for a while, but, you know, we used to all the time get Christians coming at us saying, oh, you know, you're trying to operate by situational ethics, where whether something is right or wrong depends on what's going on. And, you know, my answer then and now was, well, if you don't know exactly what's going on, you're not in a position to make a moral choice. And if you don't care what's actually going on, then you don't care about making a moral choice. You care about following rules that are supposed to apply no matter what's actually going on.
You want to take our first call?
Please.
Okay. When last I looked, we had Jim in Austin. Jim, are you there?
I am. How you doing, buddy?
I'm good. How are you?
Hi, Jim.
I'm all right. I got three things for you that I'm going to blow through real quick. Do you mind?
Not at all.
All right. Number one, you know how I know Jesus was not a black guy, as many people claim? Because he was a cracker. Dumb ching. Okay. Number two,
yeah,
the answer to your question
about
the stone in front of the tomb.
Yeah.
Depending on whether you're reading John or Matthew, John says the stone was moved, and Matthew says the stone was still there, one of the many contradictions in the Bible.
Yeah. Correct, sir. Give that man
Thank
a cracker.
I have one question for you guys.
Yes.
What's that?
Well, we were hoping to get some Christians to answer that question who
That's all
would
right.
actually explain the difference. But, yes, go on.
I was sort of hoping you guys would play devil's advocate for me on a little thought experiment. Do you mind if I give you that?
Are you sure we're going to be playing the devil's advocate, or are we going to be playing Jesus' advocate?
Well, that's a good point. How about you play Jesus' advocate and tell me if I'm wrong?
Fair enough.
Okay.
Are you
a Christian?
I'm
Jesus' advocate now. Are you a Christian?
I am an agnostic atheist.
Then you're wrong.
Here's the idea. Christians often say that the Big Bang can't have, like, nothing can't explode, like, where did the matter come from, and it must have it's the first cause argument,
uh-huh.
or something, or I forget the name, I think it's first cause. And ignoring the idea that God need not have a first cause, they say he's infinite, and that's their explanation.
Right.
So if God is infinite and has existed for an infinite amount of time, then he must have waited an infinite amount of time between the beginning of his existence, which is infinitely far because he's existed forever. He must have waited an infinite amount of time to create our universe, and since you can't wait an infinite amount of time before doing something and still have it be done, he could never have created us.
And you want to know what Christians are going to say in response to this?
What's that?
Being a Christian, I don't think that's a terribly good argument. But go on.
Well, I think the most obvious thing they're likely to say in response is, no. God exists outside of time. So you can't even begin to apply time constraints to him.
That's pretty good Christian's advocate answer. And being a math nerd, I kind of reject the premise of the problem that you've brought up, because basically a number line is infinite in extent. You know, you can go from zero to infinity or minus infinity, but that doesn't mean that the number, an arbitrary number like 2009, doesn't actually exist on the number line.
I agree. Know,
the question of waiting a certain amount of time kind of has no meaning. We happen to be right here on the timeline, and you know, there's nothing else you can say about that.
I agree, but it's the same argument that they use to explain why the universe have been infinite.
Well, that argument is stupid too.
Well, I agree, but if they're making that argument, then they can do the same thought experiment with their God.
So I'll give you props for that, because I always like turning the argument back around.
Let me just clarify, Jim, you've had Christians say to you that God doesn't have to have been created because he is infinite? That's exactly what they've said to you?
I've heard several, but it's either he's infinite, he's the Alpha and Omega, the perfect circle, all sorts of nonsensical things that aren't really answered.
Well, I mean, some of those things are just special pleading, right? He's a special kind of thing that doesn't need that, right? But specifically, if they try to say, you know, it's because he's infinite, that can't possibly wash. They're arguing that, that, you know, great big complex things have to have been created, and making God infinite just means he's an infinitely big, infinitely complex thing that, you know, it's infinitely impossible for him not to have been created on that specific point.
Sure. I agree with you. And I appreciate you guys taking my call. And I hope you all have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's get another one of these.
Okay.
Here's question number two about Easter. Jim got that last one right. According to the book of Matthew, when the women arrived at the tomb, it was still sealed.
Sorry about that.
But according to Mark, Luke, and John, when they arrived at the tomb, it was already open. Question number two. Who was at the tomb when the women arrived to visit it?
And with that, we're going to go to line three, Dan in Salt Lake. Dan, are you there?
Hello, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Hi, Dan.
Okay, you know what? I don't have a comment specifically on those questions.
Yep.
They're okay. Cool and so. But real quick, I don't even know how long it's been. I don't know. I guess I was 9 or 10 when I started really questioning. And a cool little kid in my Sunday school class asked the teacher, because, of course, they were talking about hell and, you know, burning and blah, blah, blah. And he goes, you know what? After you've been in hell for a while, wouldn't you get used to it? And that started my wheels turning. And that kid actually was a believer. I don't know if he's a believer anymore. That was 20-some-odd years ago.
Yeah.
But cool little question from a little kid that got my wheels turning. And, you know, I've been studying and trying to figure things out, and I have discovered YouTube, I don't know, a year or so ago, and been listening to the debates with Dawkins and Hitchens. Awesome stuff. And you know what? I don't care what anybody says. You guys are just as good as the big famous guys, too. So yeah. You should be proud of yourselves, pat yourselves on the back. And you guys actually saved me because I was done with all of the Hitchens and Dawkins debates. I had listened to them 2 and 3 times, and I was looking for more, and then I found the Atheist Experience. So I really appreciate that. I'm fairly new to watching the show. I've just seen some of the old ones on YouTube, and I understand that from that Jeff D was gone for a little while, and now he's back. And I really, really am glad he decided to come back. I don't know what the reasons were or whatever, but I love his, the irreverence, because it's funny, and it really drives the point home, especially with the hell argument and the immorality of threatening people with that. Love it. Jeff, keep it up. I mean, yeah, it's a little bit harsh, but somebody's got to open these people's eyes to what they're saying.
Well,
make them actually think about what they're telling people. It's not very nice. Now, a question or an opinion I would like from you guys, real quick. My father, he's a Southern Baptist minister in Salt Lake City. You know, he apparently was called by God to come to Salt Lake City and convert all the Mormons. I'm
huge
oh job. But, you know, of course, it's not being very successful. And, you know, most of it, of course, is his fault. He's not exactly the hardest working preacher out there. But the main point is he's got a small church in his house, and he mostly has fairly severely disabled people coming to his services. And I'm his son. I mean, he has supported me, aside from my atheism, of course, but he supported me with everything that I've done, every foolish, crazy idea that I've come up with. He supported me, so I feel like, you know, it's kind of my turn to do that. So I'm actually the one that's running around to these people's houses, and I pick up several of them, take them to the service, and take them home, and I provide them with food and, you know, coffee and things like that so that they're comfortable. And I know that what he's saying is wrong and dumb. Well, maybe not dumb. He's actually trying to help. It's just not truthful, and it doesn't make a whole lot of sense. But I figure I'm supporting him because he's always supported me, and he's not really doing a whole lot of damage to the world because it's, you know, people that really need a good feeling or whatever. I don't know if I'm making any sense, but I wanted to see what your opinion of this was. Not that I'm going to stop supporting him, whether you guys say I'm not right for doing it. I just wanted other atheist intelligent opinions about how I'm supporting him. Does that make sense?
I'm not clear on how you're supporting him.
Well, he's helping his father run his little church.
Okay. Does your father know you're an atheist?
Yes.
Does he know that you're uncomfortable with it?
With his church and what he's telling people?
With helping him do that.
No, probably not. Because
why
I
not?
Don't. Why does he not know?
Yeah, well, have you considered telling him?
Well, no, because I'm sure while he was supporting me in my harebrained schemes in younger days, he was uncomfortable, but he went ahead and supported me anyway. And I was doing much more damage to the world probably than he was, than he is right now, because his small little congregation is just, well, small.
Well, I mean, I don't think you're going to find that either Russell or I are going to feel like it's our business to tell you how you ought to live your life. Everybody's situation is different, and if you think that that is what you need to do, then that's what you need to do. I mean, I don't. One of the great things about atheism is we don't have a big organization that could, like, you know, frown upon you helping some church activity going on and, you know, kick you out or you know, spread bad words about you or anything. I mean, we don't operate that way. You should do what you think you need to do.
Right. At the same time, and, you know, this isn't really my business, except that you asked me, and I don't know your family situation all that well, but it seems to me that if your dad is... knows you're an atheist and is still asking you to help him spread the religion around, then he's taking advantage of you in some way. I mean, that's just the thought that springs into my head when I hear what you said. I mean, you know, I'm not trying to sow discord between your family. If you're fine with that, then I don't care, but I'd be worried about that in that situation.
Of being taken advantage of. That makes sense. That's a very good point. And you know what? I don't, you know, of course I'm not going to take offense, and I'm glad you guys said that. You know, the atheist community is not a big group of people that are totally against religion. I understand, and I feel
well,
the same way.
We are totally against religion. We're not totally against, you know, people making the decisions about what to do in their private lives that they think they need to make. And that's a whole separate question.
Right.
Yeah, and you know what? To tell you the truth, I'm probably also doing it to make sure that he knows that atheists are not bad people, because I happen to be the only sibling, and I've got about five siblings, brothers
and
sisters,
but you don't
that are also believers, and none of them attend his church. I'm the unbeliever, and I'm the one... actually supporting.
Right,
what
but
he's
just
doing.
Because you want to present a nice face for atheism doesn't mean that you can't clearly express that you don't like what you're doing and see what he thinks about that. I mean, you know, you could at least tell him and not and still do it, but at least let him know that there's a problem. I don't know.
Yeah, and you know, it's not that I'm uncomfortable doing it, because I like helping people, and that's another thing that you guys should really pat yourselves on the back for, is doing your blood drives and doing all of the good things in society that you're doing, even though you have no religious affiliation and you don't have a big ghost in the sky telling you to do that. And so you guys should pat yourselves on the back about that. And, you know, I'm not that uncomfortable with helping people. I'm just a little bit uncomfortable because, you know, I'm taking these people to my dad's little church, and then he's, you know, showing movies about you know, superstitious and, well, more, probably worse, is the supernatural stuff, you know, that miracles can happen and magic stuff can happen, and getting these people to believe that. That's really the only problem I have.
I mean, could you possibly use your position in that to, you know, bring those people some actual practical information that they could use? I don't know exactly what that would consist of. I mean, you'd have to look around and see if there are social services that they're not aware of, and put them in contact with that. With that, you know, take advantage of the fact that your father's gathering these people together, and use that to help them. It's an idea.
Yeah, that does make sense. And when they are having discussions, you know, they're talking about Paul and his leadership abilities and things like that. I always just keep my mouth shut when they're talking about magic, but when they're talking about being good to other people and leadership and things like that, then I'll pipe in and give my opinion there. But, I mean, I'm sure in the discussions they know that I'm being silent about the supernatural stuff. So I'm sure that most of the people in the church realize that I'm not a believer.
Mm-hmm. All right.
But they don't mind, you know, they're great people.
Oh, sure.
And I don't mind helping them at all. But I don't know, I guess I do feel a little bit guilty sending them to, you know, a little class that talked about, you know, that magic is real, that type of thing.
Yeah, yeah. It's difficult, but, you know, I have been in similar situations with my family.
And I haven't.
So
family full of atheists.
So, you know, you got my sympathy.
Play
it the way you think you need to, man.
Yep.
It's your life.
Yeah.
And that's okay.
Yeah, you guys made a couple of really good points, and that's why I brought it up, just to hear what your opinions were.
Thanks,
I really appreciate it, and you're doing good stuff. Keep it up.
Thanks, Dan.
All right, thanks for the support, Dan. Bye. Actually, I do have a quick comment about the hell thing.
Yeah.
Which was, I'd be remiss if I didn't bring up the opposite point of view. He said that if you're in hell for an eternity, then you might get used to it.
Right.
There's a Twilight Zone episode where this guy goes to what he thinks is heaven, and everything is perfect, and there's no problems with anything, and he always wins at gambling, and girls are falling all over him, and he realizes it's incredibly boring. At which point he realizes that he's actually in hell.
But wouldn't he eventually get used to it being that boring?
I would start out being used to it that boring, but I don't know. The episode had a good point to make, I thought.
Mm. Do we have more callers?
We do have a lot more callers.
We're still looking for somebody who wants to answer the question.
Yes,
in the Bible,
in
the story of Jesus' resurrection, when the women go to the tomb, who's there? That's the question. Who's already there?
Okay. Line two, we have Mike in Grand Forks, North Dakota. Is that right?
Yeah, it's me. Am I on the air?
Yes.
Awesome, cool. I have a quick question for either one of you two. First of all, I'm a theist, and my question is, do you feel that certain abstracts can exist independent of thinking minds?
And whether... you're asking, can an abstract exist independent of thinking minds?
Yes, such as beauty, tranquility, serenity, the feeling you get when summoning a mountain.
Subjective things cannot exist apart from a mind. In fact, that it's arguable that they don't exist, that they are merely expressions of opinion.
So you think they're concepts of the imagination, basically?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, in the case of beauty, beauty is actually something that appeals to somebody. And if there's no somebody being referred to, then with that particular abstract concept, beauty being in the eye of the beholder, it only exists if there's a beholder. I would say if there was nobody, then there wouldn't be any beauty.
Okay. Well, beauty is a pretty, that's a pretty general definition of a word. You can't really pin down exactly what beauty is.
Maybe not.
But do you think there is any possible abstract that does exist independent of a thinking mind or no?
Can you give an example?
Well, how about the feeling you get, like, when you climb a mountain or something like that? When the sun's rising up behind it, Do you think that thought's just a manifestation of the mind?
The feeling we get when? I missed that. You talked very fast. Are the feeling we get from
what? Sorry about that. Say a climber was climbing a mountain at sunrise, and the sun was coming up on the horizon.
Yeah.
Do you think that's a feeling in the mind, or do you think that's an actual...
Feelings are in the brain.
And do you think that's a feeling?
Sure. Feelings are feelings.
Wait, what...
I think.
Do we think what's a feeling?
You,
the you climbing
called it,
part?
You called or? It a feeling, so I'm agreeing
yeah,
with
yeah,
you.
Yeah, I'm talking about the feeling is a feeling. The existence of abstracts. Do they exist only in the mind, or do they exist as a tangible abstract in actual space?
Can you give more examples? Because they all seem to be coming down to feelings so far. Do you have an example of an abstract that you don't think is a feeling?
Hello? He's gone.
Are you there?
No, he's gone.
Okay. I suspect that Mike... I need to see more callers, by the way. We're having internet problems today. Or I am. But I suspect that Mike might have been trying to bring up the transcendental argument, which Matt Slick brought up a few weeks ago. And I think opinions are split as to whether we should ever, ever talk about that again. I think you were in the no camp yourself. Is that right?
I would... If we talk about it now, then we're talking about it again.
Right. Okay, so we're going to pass on that and just refer you to the show a few weeks ago. I think it's advertised on the website that Matt talked to apologist Matt Slick. And everything you will ever want to hear about the transcendental argument took place in that conversation and was followed up in the Atheist Experience blog. So check that out. In the meantime, next we've got Blake in New York. Hello, Blake.
Hey, how you guys doing?
Fine. Good. How are you?
I'm all right. I just wanted to detract from your current topic a little bit, if I could. First of all, happy Zombie Jesus Day, by the way.
Thanks.
Now, I know you guys were talking a little bit about the transcendental argument just now, and I wanted to talk a little bit about the creation evolution debate. I know you guys talk about that a lot on the show, and I actually am myself an atheist, so I'm not... you know, vouching for the Christians by any stretch of the imagination here, but I came across a semi-interesting piece of evidence for creation the other day. I was wondering if you guys could comment on it. It's about the, I believe it's one of the laws of thermodynamics. I'm not sure if you guys have talked about this yet already on your show. And what it basically says is that everything in the tangible world is in a constant state of decay, and evolution kind of contradicts that by saying that instead of getting... you know, shorter, dumber, stupider, man is getting bigger, taller, better suited for their environment, or not necessarily man, just the whole of living things, and everything is getting better suited for the Earth, and that's not necessarily a state of decay. That's quite the opposite, actually.
Okay, may I take this?
Please.
Because I love the second law of thermodynamics. Actually, people who say that the second law of thermodynamics... states that everything winds down and decays do not understand the actual second law of thermodynamics. Because what the second law of thermodynamics actually says is that in a closed system, the amount of entropy, which is the amount of energy that is no longer available to do work, will increase. The key factor here is the concept of a closed system. In other words, if you have like a source of heat sitting in a box that is closed and no heat can enter or exit the box, then eventually that heat will sort of dissipate and spread out throughout the box and no longer be sort of a focused source of heat. The Earth isn't a closed system. You might have noticed, notice if you walk out around noon on some days, that there's this big giant thing full of energy that is continuously beaming stuff down on the Earth. The second law of thermodynamics doesn't say anything in particular about how a system behaves when it's got energy coming in all the time. And as a matter of fact, if you want to believe that the second law of thermodynamics prevents prevents evolution from happening, you have to also believe that just standing up and walking around is also prevented by the second law of thermodynamics. Because in a closed system, people tend to reach equilibrium with their environment. which means they reach the same state as the world around them, which is a condition technically known as dead. People don't just drop dead from the moment they're born because they are constantly eating food and breathing air, which is generated thanks to plants and stuff that get energy from the sun, right?
Exactly. Now, just another quick tidbit of this here. You know, I actually, just as I said before, I actually am an atheist, so I'm not, you know, I'm not trying to pick any fights with you guys here.
Right.
So you really think the whole principle of constant decay isn't valid because the Earth isn't a closed system and there's energy coming in? Is that what you're trying to say, basically?
That the second law of thermodynamics does not apply to evolution on the Earth because there's energy coming into the Earth from the sun.
Right.
Excellent. Okay, thank you. That's really all I needed.
Yeah.
Right, thanks for your call, Blake.
Bye. Thanks. The second law of thermodynamics applies everywhere. It's just that it doesn't say what creationists think it says.
Okay. Still waiting for an answer to the question, in the Bible, the women go to visit the tomb, who's already there?
Right. Who's on the line now? Which line? Line three. Joseph in California, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Sorry, I'm having trouble hearing you. I did have an answer to your question.
All right.
Okay.
Going over the Gospels, I'm an atheist, and after I finally lost faith...
I think all the Christians are in church today, and that's why they're not calling us.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
And also, I've noticed from past experience on this show, anytime you come prepared to talk about some, you know, Bible contradiction issue or anything, and you clearly are ready to talk about it, they don't call. It's a fact.
Oh, well.
Go on.
That means that we atheists get to say what the Bible means today. Goody.
That's awesome. So go on.
Well, I actually started reading the Bible. One of the reason I lost faith was because the Bible condoned slavery. After that did it. I just couldn't dance around it anymore. But anyways, I studied the Gospels to see if there's some contradiction in the New Testament. I found many of them. And the ones I was most proud of was the situation you're talking about when they go to the tomb, who was already there. I think in one of them it said there were two Roman soldiers there, and then there was some sort of earthquake, and the stone got rolled aside, and the soldiers fell unconscious or something or ran away. And then in another, there was no one there.
Hey, Joseph, let's not get ahead of ourselves because we might have questions related to those other things. We're limited right now to just who's there, not what happens after they see who's there.
All right, okay.
Else we might not be able to ask our other questions later. Spoilers.
And there was, I think, they saw Jesus, in another one they saw Jesus there, and he said something to them, and in another one they saw one angel there sitting on top of the rock, and another one or two angels inside of the tomb.
Yeah. You're doing this from memory, right?
Yeah.
You're like a little bit off on every single one of those, but in point of fact, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all give completely different answers to this question.
Yeah.
Along the lines of the things that you just said, right? Mm-hmm. But it's a different situation every single story, every single version of the story. Amazing, isn't it?
Yeah. Okay,
is that all you got?
That's pretty much it.
Okay.
Thank you for taking my call.
Thanks for calling, Joseph.
Happy Easter. Goodbye.
We've got an Austin caller next, and then I'd like to make some another comment about the resurrection story after we take Al in Austin, who I believe wants to answer some more of your questions, or at least the last one. I'm sorry, but Joseph seems to have stolen your thunder. But are you there, Al?
I'm here.
Hi.
Hi. Well, my answer to that question was the Archangel Gabriel.
Mm-hmm.
That's it? That's your answer?
That's my answer.
Yeah.
Okay.
That might fit with the book of Matthew, which says that there was an angel there.
Okay.
None of the other four books, Mark, Luke, or John, specify angels. They talk about... Matthew says one angel, John says two angels, Mark says a young man, and Luke says two men.
Oh, okay. Well, the reason I guessed Archangel Gabriel is because the Archangel Gabriel seems to be the spokesman of God, seems to be the one that appears to believe the Archangel Gabriel appears to Muhammad and perhaps Abraham.
Bear in mind that this was written like 700 years before there was a Muhammad.
Right. But
well, it's an angel.
I have it in my brain.
Yeah.
I'm just saying that the fictional stuff in the Bible doesn't necessarily relate to the fictional stuff in the Quran, except to the extent that the Quran is homage.
And it's interesting speculation, Al, but in fact, point of fact, none of the four books that carry this story identify either the men or angels by name.
Okay. All right. Well... Yeah,
but,
Christians
feel free to stick stuff in the Bible that's not actually there in order to reconcile stuff like this, so I don't see any reason why you can't do it, too. Sure, it was Gabriel.
Well, no, that's not what I was saying. I was just thinking, there's a strain that goes between all the monotheistic religions. I mean, that they all three of the major monotheistic religions all have a common...
that's no surprise.
Well, yeah.
There's strains running through Christianity that come from polytheistic religions.
Right.
Before and after it, that it ran into later.
Right.
Yeah.
The religions swipe stuff from one another all the damn time.
Christianity is an evolutionary branch off of Judaism, and Islam is another evolutionary branch, so it's no surprise that we see similarities between them.
Right. Like today's holiday, Easter, swiped from the pagans.
Right. And Islam was, first there was Judaism, and then there was Christianity, and then the last of the great monotheistic religions is Islam. Everything kind of gets borrowed from the previous... the previous religion.
Sure.
And then also
Joseph
from
Smith. Joseph Smith, when he invented Mormonism, made reference to Islam and was calling himself like the new Muhammad.
Right. And to me, that just kind of proves how man has developed religion, and that there's no God out there. There's never been a God.
If I can play Jesus' advocate again for a second, just because...
You're wrong.
Yes. Just because there are fraudulent religions doesn't logically demonstrate that all religions are fraudulent. It's kind of like this example James, the Amazing Randy, showing how you can bend spoons like Uri Geller, and he said, "Well, just because I can bend spoons using sleight of hand doesn't mean that Uri Geller doesn't have magic powers. It's just that if he's bending the spoons by magic, then he's doing it the hard way." Same thing with the religions. They might be supernaturally inspired, but we already know that people can make stuff up and turn it into a big religion.
Right. And to me, that's the essential point, is that religion is pretty much man-made. I mean, humans developed it. If humans didn't die, and if humans didn't believe in magic, I don't think there would be religion. That's how I feel about it. But
I think you'd find we tend to agree.
Yep.
Okay. All right. But anyway, I just thought I'd give it a shot at trying to answer that.
Thanks, Al.
That question. So, and,
no cracker
like show.
For you, I'm afraid, but but good try.
Appreciate it.
All right. Thank you for calling.
I have another one.
We still have 30 minutes left, so
yep.
I'm actually going to save my commentary for nearer the end of the
All
program.
Right.
So go on. What's the next question?
After Mary returned from the tomb, did she know that Jesus had been resurrected? Yes or no? Do, do, We got more calls?
Yeah, we have Dan who's calling from Austin.
Another Dan?
Hello?
Hi, Dan.
Hi, Dan.
Dan?
Hey, you guys are real quiet, but how you doing?
We'll try to be louder, but we have no control over the technical stuff from here.
Well, that's all right. I'll just listen really hard.
Okay.
Okay. I'll tell you what, I got proof of God.
You do?
But
oh, goody.
It's not proof that I can give to you, but I can tell you exactly how to prove it to yourself, okay?
Uh-huh.
All right. First, kill yourself, and then you'll go to hell, and then you'll be like, oh, there's a God. But not that you should kill yourself, because then you would obviously go to hell. But if you were to do that,
I think the whole point of the question is to find out, you know, beforehand so we can make a smart decision. It's kind of too late.
Unfortunately,
if you
the Bible is the only way to know that, and since you refuse to listen to the words of God, then you're
but the Bible's not a way to know that. That's the thing.
Yeah,
that was just a book.
It says right in it.
The Lord of the Rings says right in it that there's, you know, Sauron who lives in the land of Mordor.
How long ago was Lord of the Rings written?
Okay, the Iliad says that there's sirens living on an island that captured Odysseus. That was written.
Was that written before the
Bible?
Yeah. Yes, it was.
Yes, sir.
Before the Old Testament?
Oh, yes, sir.
There was nothing written before the Old Testament. In the beginning, there was the Word. Oh,
wow.
I'm afraid you're incorrect.
Not necessarily the Old Testament,
I'm
the
afraid
word
you're
of God,
incorrect. You know, there's way older religions even than Judaism.
But in the beginning, there was always the Word.
Yeah,
I know that.
Dude, you know,
know
if you're just going to... If you're just going to take the Bible's word for it that it's the first book, you're going to miss the fact that it's not. And there's nothing we can really do about that. It's up to you to, like, pay attention to what's actually going on.
Well, how can you demonstrate to me that it's not the word?
Do five minutes of research on the internet.
Yeah, China. China has some
right,
pretty
how do
stuff.
I how do I research
China
that?
Developed
what should I do?
We're not going to be able to explain step by step. There's these things called search engines, and they like... Uh-huh. Like Google, they let you type in words, and it'll give you links to pages where it talks about things using those words, and you try to find
what
the information you're looking for, huh?
What words should I type into the
you
Google?
Could start typing religions older than Judaism.
Yeah,
Google,
figure it out, man.
Google is
that'll
smart.
Use your brain. You're an evolved being. You should be able to figure it out.
I'm not an evolved being, and I don't appreciate you calling me a monkey either. I think that's offensive.
I don't believe I did call you a monkey, sir.
I
believe
I
called
evolved.
You an evolved being.
I
may have called
monkey,
your great-great-great-great... I'd have to go back several hundred thousand generations.
Oh, look, there it is, our special guide.
There's a little guide to looking stuff up on Google.
You're saying that there was a guy in my family history that was a monkey...
Well, except I wouldn't call him a guy at that point on account of he was a monkey.
But it was one of my
have been a male monkey.
He was a monkey and he gave birth to something that wasn't a monkey. Is that what you're saying?
No, see, evolution happens gradually, and so, sounds like you've got your work cut out for you, educating yourself on what's actually going on. Thanks very much for your call, Dan.
Okay, nice talking to you, Dan. Are we done?
Yeah, I'm done.
All right. Okay, let's see. What's the current question?
Mary,
we should have asked Dan to answer the question.
Oh, yeah, I should have. That was a chance missed. When Mary, he just wanted us to kill ourselves. When Mary returned from the tomb, did she know that Jesus had been resurrected or not, according to the Bible?
Well, we got Steve in Boston. Hey, Steve.
Hey, what's up, guys?
How are you?
Okay, I think I have the answer to the question, but
you
first
do.
I'll answer the first question actually, because I think everyone else got it wrong.
Okay.
What one?
The first one about who was there at the tomb.
Who was at the tomb, right.
Yeah, okay, I'll answer that question first.
Yeah?
It was Russell's sister. She was lounging around and said...
She was actually there, because she's really, really old. You wouldn't know it. She has aged extremely well.
Huh.
Who's next? No more calls.
All right.
Actually, lines two and three are unidentified right now.
So, you got something? You want to do your thing now?
I do want to comment on all these weird differences between the different books of the Bible.
Well, let's fess up. The point of our little this little game is to show that the books of the Bible, on the most important point, the story of the resurrection of Jesus, they just don't agree.
There's,
I've got pages and pages here full of.
Where are you reading this from?
This is chapter 24 of Dan Barker's book, Losing Faith in Faith.
Yep.
And you don't have to zoom in on that. That's all right. There's just all these things and the different books of the Bible that when they talk about these issues at all, they just don't agree on what you'd think would be the single most important thing, the thing that many Christians voluntarily admit. If Jesus didn't resurrect, then Christianity is pointless.
I was listening to the radio last night, in fact, and there was a preacher giving a sermon about that very thing, saying that he had asked his congregation, if you found out tomorrow that Jesus' body had been dug up and it was provable that it was Jesus' body and he hadn't been resurrected, would you keep going to church? And he said, a lot of the people I asked said yes, which surprised me because I wouldn't. I'd go out and get drunk. And
well, I hope after getting drunk, he would reassess his life and figure out something.
Well,
the
question I would have liked to ask him at that point was, do you think you would actually enjoy getting drunk? Because he said it in such a contemptuous way that it made me wonder if he would go out and get drunk just because he felt it was something he had to do.
That's strange.
I've been drunk a couple of times and personally didn't enjoy the experience that much.
Right. But these are the versions of the story supposedly written by eyewitnesses.
Mm-hmm.
Depending on which branch of Christianity we're talking about, I guess some people are aware that they're not. But if they're supposed to be written by eyewitnesses, how come so much wide disagreement on the specifics? It's amazing.
Right. Now, if you ask Christians about this, one of the things that you'll come up with commonly, and I guess I was waiting a little bit to see if anybody would try to spit out this answer, but like I said, they're all in church today, so I'll have to be Jesus' advocate
again.
Not
a couple of them.
They say, okay, if you had a car crash and all the witnesses described it differently, so some of them said that the car was green and some of them said it was sort of off green, and they couldn't agree on various minor niggling details like were there four people or five in the crash and what model and make of the car it was. You still wouldn't, you'd be foolish to just reject the idea that there was an accident at all.
Right.
Right.
But that's a car accident, which we know actually happens. We have car accidents. I've actually seen some. I've been in one.
Mm-hmm.
So the standard of evidence necessary to establish that it happened is way lower. Because it's not that big of a stretch.
And also, I mean, they do try to come up with, in their fake car crash story, as niggling little inconsequential details as possible.
Right.
Instead of, I don't remember everything in here, but there's one passage where Jesus is preaching in one city in one book, and a city like 100 miles away in another book.
The author forgot which city 100 miles away.
But it's like if one of them said that there was a car crash in San Diego and another one said it was in Detroit, you might think that they weren't talking about the same thing.
Yeah. The whole defense is unreasonable because if there were, a small group of people who were trying to fake the story of a car crash, how would you determine that they had made this up? Well, you'd interview them separately, and you'd notice inconsistencies in their story. That's exactly how you'd go about finding out.
You can't say,
oh, well, you know, some inconsistencies are to be expected, unless you're also willing to agree that all people trying to pull scams have to be believed, because you can't count inconsistencies in their stories as evidence that they made it up.
Right. Yeah, so I guess that's that. Frank in Austin, are you there?
Yes, hello.
Hi, Frank. Hi.
Hey, how you guys doing?
Good.
We're great.
Okay, all right. I just got a quick question, and I'm not calling to belittle you guys by any means, or to be belittled or anything. I'm just wondering, okay, atheist, is it just God, period, or just the God in the Holy Bible, or God just in the Muslim, or just God, period?
Oh, that is such a good question. Whether I'm I call myself an atheist because most of the time when people talk about God, they're talking about one that I don't believe in, right? But there are people on South Seas Islands that worship totem poles, and if they showed me their totem pole and said, that's my God, I would have to agree their God exists. I would not necessarily agree with them that it had all the magical powers that they attribute to it, right?
You know,
but as far as that God is concerned, I would not be an atheist. I'd say I could go and rap on it with my knuckles. Same thing with, like, you know, Julius Caesar, who was declared a god by the Roman Senate. Okay, I mean, I don't think he had any actual powers, but that's a god I can't deny the existence of.
Well,
but
really,
generally,
the god I'm referring to is like a creator type, you know, like
that's the kind of thing I don't believe in.
Okay, just like a Big Bang or something, or
I'm sorry.
Is it like the Big Bang or something? Or?
The current,
well, that's not a god.
The best scientific understanding of the origins of the universe, we've got it. Of this universe. The cosmologists have it traced back to a Big Bang event.
Okay.
That is the result scientists have gotten by looking at the actual evidence instead of being informed of the origin of the universe by reading an ancient holy book.
Right. Well, like, I'm a soldier, right? So, like, I've been through experiences that have made me actually, you know, think that I've seen, not necessarily seen God, but felt his presence at times. But, you know, who's to say that's just not peace of mind or something? You know, nobody knows for sure. It's just...
That's a very good point. Nobody does actually know for sure. And you would think that if there were a God who were all-powerful and all-knowing and knew exactly how people go about knowing stuff, then it would be a lot more obvious than it actually is. That's all we're saying.
And you know what? I'm not going to even argue with you guys, because it's any educated man that actually reads the Bible and sits down and reads it with the facts and reads it without being, you know, swayed to think a certain way is going to have doubts.
And that's healthy.
Yep.
And in fact, I should add here that on many definitions of God, our atheism is not absolute, right? I mean, we look at the available evidence and we say, can't believe in that yet, because there's just not compelling evidence. But if the compelling evidence comes along, we'll be happy to believe in it. We'll be happy to believe anything anybody can actually prove.
Okay. All right. Okay, guys, y'all have a good afternoon.
Before you go, did you want to play our little Easter game?
Sure. What you got?
Okay. In the Bible, in the story of Jesus' resurrection, Mary goes with some women to the tomb of Jesus, and the question is, after she returned from the tomb, did she at that point know that Jesus had resurrected or not, according to the Bible?
She thought somebody stole the body.
Well, in fact, Matthew, Mark, and Luke all say that she did realize that Jesus had resurrected, but according to the book of John, she didn't.
Okay, yeah, I always thought that she thought somebody had stolen the body.
Well, in fact, the different books disagree.
Oh, all four
with,
of them?
With one another. Well, John disagrees with the other three.
Okay,
on this
three one disagrees with three.
Yeah, we're just, you know, we're going through these the various accounts of Jesus' resurrection, which is, that's the whole point of Easter today, right? and showing that the Bible's wildly inconsistent. I'm sorry?
The Gospels were supposed to be written 40, 50, 60 years after the
actual...
Yeah.
And remarkably, those things that we have that were 40, 50, 60 years after his death are the only historical record that we have of any person named Jesus from that time period. We don't have, supposedly Jesus rose up from the dead and walked around in front of 500 people. And yet, nobody thought to write that down.
According
at the time.
To one account, the tombs opened up and all kinds of dead people got up and started walking around.
You know,
there's no independent confirmation of that either.
Bombs.
Yeah. So, all right. Well, thanks for calling, Frank.
Okay, guys. Take care.
All right. You too. Bye.
All right. I would have to have another question then.
Yeah.
So, at what point did Mary first see Jesus? This is kind of a giveaway that there's going to be a disagreement here, right? Because we just established that. But the question then is, if there's disagreement on whether she knew that Jesus had been resurrected after visiting the tomb, at what point did she first see him? And we'll take your calls.
Do we need to make this multiple choice, or no? Okay.
No. The Bible already makes it multiple choice, Russell.
That's true.
We don't have to do anything.
Nick in Austin, are you there?
Hello?
Hi.
Nick?
Hi, I'm sorry I'm having trouble hearing you guys, because it seems to be a common trend today.
Sorry, yeah, man. Apparently. It's the control room.
It's all good. Well, basically I called to answer your question, but I think you just posed a new one. I think I might have an answer to that one.
Okay, when did Mary first see Jesus after her visit,
Well, if I'm recalling, I'm an ex-Mormon from about 10 years back.
Yeah.
And I remember taking early morning classes on scripture.
Do Mormons have to study both the Bible and the Book of Mormon?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, just curious.
They actually consider both to be valid accounts. They just consider the Book of Mormon to be the more accurate account and less tampered with.
Okay, sure.
Less tampered with. Yeah, that's a good one.
So go on.
Tampered with so much now. I mean, I see there's been like hundreds of edits since it was first incepted by Joseph Smith.
Yeah, that's true. In the case of Joseph Smith, it was only one guy screwing with you.
Well, it's been tempered with since then, too. So, one of the reasons I left. but as far as the question of when Mary saw Jesus, now, if I'm recalling correctly, it's been a while. Let me see.
Now, you're free to actually consult a Bible and get back to us.
Well, I don't really have one handy unless I want to pull up the skeptic fantasy.
I think they're suggesting you could Google it.
But as I recall, they saw Jesus went upon leaving the tomb in one account, and in another account, they left all the way back to the city to find, I believe it was Peter, and then they came back, and then they saw Jesus. But I'm a little hazy on whether it's different in all four.
The information I have in front of me only concerns the books of Matthew, Mark, and John.
Okay.
Luke, I would assume, just doesn't mention it. According to Matthew and Mark, she had already seen Jesus before she returned to the disciples.
Right.
But according to John, after she returned to the disciples, she saw Jesus for the first time.
Okay. Basically, right. Wow. I don't remember the names of the books.
Yeah. All right. Well, thanks for playing, Nick.
Yeah, it's fun. I enjoy you guys' show.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Have a good one.
And we enjoy being watched by you and stuff.
All right. Here's the next question.
Do you have the one about where Jesus was preaching?
No, that's not the resurrection story.
Oh, it's not?
No.
Or, I mean...
I mean, after he reappeared?
He showed up in some city as zombie Jesus, I thought.
We'll get to that question. The next one is, after those women we've been talking about that went to visit the tomb, after the women, to whom did Jesus first appear?
Okay, Tommy in Austin, are you there?
Yeah, hello.
Hi, Tommy.
Hi.
What's going on?
Good.
Nothing.
I would have to say, if you guys wanted to know, who did he appear after?
Yeah, after the women that went to visit the tomb, Who were the very next people or person that Jesus appeared to after the women?
According to the Bible. To his homeboys, the disciples.
The disciples?
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Unless you can tell me where to look, then I'll look for it.
Well, you're free to, if you'd rather go away and consult the Bible and then call us back, you're welcome to do that. But we probably will have moved on from this question. Really, right. What viewers need to be doing is having their Bibles on hand and looking these things up instantly.
I'm not
when
none of our right callers have thought of that.
I'm sorry?
No, yeah, it's right here.
Okay, go ahead. Well, now that's gonna be dead air. Yeah. I'll tell you what. Do you want to go with your first answer? He appeared to the disciples?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, that would be correct according to the book of Matthew. According to the book of Mark, he appeared to two of the disciples out in the country and later to the full 11. According to Luke, he appeared to two disciples in Emmaus, I guess that's some town, and later to the rest, to the full 11. According to John, he appeared to 10 disciples. Judas and Thomas were absent. And according to the book of Paul, he appeared to first to Cephas, Peter, and then to the 12, except that that can't be correct, even though it says 12, because Judas was dead by that point.
Yeah.
So there you go. No cracker for you. It's not your fault. The Bible's contradictory.
Well, no, yeah, I mean, one thing I don't understand is like, the Catholic Bible, there's, like, a couple of books that aren't in the non-denominational.
That's correct.
And I don't know why. Like, I really don't know. Do you guys know why?
And, I'm sorry?
Do you guys know the answer to that? Like, why those books aren't in there?
I don't know the precise answer to that. Do you know the precise answer to why the Catholic Bible is different from the Protestant Bible?
No, I don't know why.
Don't even get me started on how many versions of the Ten Commandments there are in the Bible. You'd be amazed.
No, yeah, that's cool. All right, guys.
Okay.
Thanks, Tommy. Right.
Thanks for calling.
No problem, man.
These questions have, like, taken over the show, but...
Yes. And pardon me for always looking at my computer. I'm really not playing video games on the air today. I just have to keep looking off screen to see what who the next caller is. And it looks like Dan has called back, and he's used the Google.
Oh!
And discovered that there is some proof that God exists.
Okay.
On Google, no less. Who would have thought that? Dan?
Yeah, I thought that I would apply your guys the same idea to you. That you okay. said to me,
yeah?
Is I Googled proof of God, because yeah. that's more interesting than the lies on the atheist websites. And I, by the way, I don't appreciate being hung up on when I'm trying to have a conversation with you. It's very dishonest of you.
Okay.
I know it. And I
we are trying to
say,
do a show here and, you know, give everybody a chance to talk. Go on.
Well, I wanted to say that the evidence that I found is that according to allaboutcreation.org, the E. coli bacterial flagellum is irreducibly complex. Do you know what that means?
It means
yes.
that website is perpetuating a falsehood
by Michael Behe and dealt with in the Kitzmiller versus Dover case, which basically laughed Behe out of court, almost.
Yeah,
theory by the Christians, right?
But
help, there's proof of God on my head.
I don't know about conspiracy theory. I don't think I'd take it that far. But there are people who are spinning this nonsense that the bacterial flagellum could not have evolved. And they used that as an argument why it ought to be okay to teach creationism in public schools. Trying to
really
say that that's evidence of creationism. And that was... that. Argument was trotted out in the Dover, Pennsylvania evolution trial, Kitzmiller versus...
Yeah, right. That was in 2005?
And the creationists that trotted that out got laughed out of court.
Yeah, basically, Michael Behe said, Michael Behe went up in front of the judge and he said, there has been no papers written on the topic of how the flagellum could have evolved. At which point, the opposing lawyer in a bit of courtroom theater walked in with this giant stack of like 20 something books and dropped it on the table in front of Behe and said, have you read these by any chance? And Behe said, no,
that?
I haven't gotten around to them.
Yeah.
When was that?
2005, Kitzmiller versus Dover, well, Kitzmiller.
If that was that long ago, and they already proved that it wasn't right, then why would allaboutcreation.org have that still on their main page?
What a softball question. Because the people who run creation, what was it? Allaboutcreation.org are idiots who don't care about the truth, is why.
You're just saying that because you disagree, and if anyone
disagrees with you,
we're not just an idiot.
That, Dan, we're not just saying it because we disagree. We're saying it because that argument has been proved to be false, but there it is on that website. Now, I guess it's also possible they're simply not maintaining the site. It might be that they're not fools or liars. It could be that they just, you know, ran out of money or lost interest and they're not maintaining their site and it's old information that hasn't been updated. That's possible.
Well,
it is. You do find sometimes... I'm sorry?
The site was updated... No, in 2009 the site was updated, so...
Oh, okay.
Fools or liars, then. I'm sorry. That is just an inescapable consequence of having a disproved claim still on their website.
Well, you know, there's
it's not
more
just
than that
we
on
disagree.
There. There's intelligent design, and there's proofs from nature and stuff. Maybe you should Google proof that there's a God, and then you should come back tomorrow and be like, sorry, I was wrong.
Well, we won't be on the air tomorrow, but if you would like to call back next week with your
favorite
proof.
We are the guys who have known how to Google all along, and we've been all over... Like, more arguments for God's existence and for the proof of creationism and everything else that you could possibly imagine. We've been at
I've been at this for
over 10 years, dude. And I'm just telling you,
like a couple of years after you, right?
I've seen, you know, squillions of different arguments for God, and they all fall down. I've looked seriously. I don't mind believing in a God if there's evidence that there is one, but there's not.
You go around spinning all the time.
I'm sorry?
You do have a problem with believing in a God because if there's a God, then you can't go around spinning all the time and just feel just fine about it.
That would be fine.
Is that what you would do if you didn't think there was a God? Is that the kind of
reason not to sin? Then I just go around and like. Do whatever I want, like gamble and curse and whatever else I want.
So you don't care about the actual consequences of your actions in the real world? The only reason you don't do bad things is because of God? Is that really true?
Then the universe will eventually wind down to a heat death, and that means that nothing I will have ever done will ever matter, and I can just do whatever I want because nothing will matter at the point of the end of the universe.
And what you really want to do is a bunch of bad things?
Bad things that make me feel good. I don't care about if nobody else matters, and I don't care about what makes
okay.
them feel good.
Ah,
so nobody else matters to you.
If nobody else matters, like the...
No,
like
no,
the
to you.
We're out of time. You're going to have to call back next week. In the meantime, I've been forgetting to plug this, but come to Threadgills after the show
if
and
you
hang
want.
Out with us if you want to. you know, bye, because there's the ending screen. We're out of time. Bye.
Is he still on the line?
No, I hung up.
Aww. That was fun.
Twice, yes. That was fun. We got... What is with that backdrop? Okay.
Yeah, that's Reagan Bazaar. He's burning in hell. That's what's happening.
Yes.
He's burning in
hell. We still have people on the internet.
He's not a flower with bugs all over him.
I'll give you... What's that? What?
Did you still
need
the...
No. Well, I mean, Is the other guy still on the line? Who was that?
Are we going to take post-show calls?
David and Austin. Do you mind
sure, what
hanging
the
out for a few more
a few minutes? No
post-show
problem.
Calls? David and Austin, are you there?
Hello?
Hi. You're not on live TV anymore, but you're still streaming out to several hundred internet watchers.
Well, thank you for taking my call.
Okay.
I tell you, you know, it gets old sitting here forever while y'all just go on and on with the most off-the-wall people.
I'm sorry, but the off-the-wall people are the fun ones.
Instead of talking more to the serious guys.
Well, you got something serious to say? Go ahead, man.
Well, of course, I take it seriously.
And you're,
actually,
you're,
I just, I'm a real, what would you say, student of the of this debate.
Uh-huh.
You know, hang on, before you say anything, can I ask you, we like to take your kind of caller. It would be good if you would call in next week early in the show so that you could have a discussion with Matt and whoever else is on next week.
You know, I don't know what was wrong today. Maybe y'all just had a couple lines open or something, but I sat here for almost 30 minutes getting a busy signal.
I'm sorry about that. We go out over the internet, and there are people from all over the world who are trying to call us, actually. So,
oh, that's a neat thing.
So, yeah, it is neat. But well, anyway, what
means,
do you got?
That means I need to get your autograph.
Well, no. We don't need the sarcasm. Come on.
No, I'm not kidding.
Okay.
Please don't take that sarcastically. That was not meant that way at all.
All right. Well, if you want our autograph, come on down
and
the thread.
And I wasn't saying no, responding to perceived sarcasm. I'm saying we're just some morons on TV. I don't know about Russell. I'm not in this for fame. Just not. I find
well,
it interesting.
I kind of like, you know, Matt's on usually. And
Matt's
I watch
on
Matt,
usually.
And I've got a lot of respect, you know, for Matt and for the other guys that have been on a lot.
Uh-huh.
And I remember you used to be on a few years ago all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I used to be the host at one point.
That's back before I would call.
Yeah.
Before I knew anything. Mm. So there was no point for me to call.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to call in with two quick things. I didn't want to waste a lot of time or anything here.
Sure.
It's too late now. But the first thing I just wanted to point out, you might remember, and for some reason most people don't, there were three different Marys involved at the resurrection.
Right.
And we can't always just assume that it's talking about the one and very same of the three Marys time it puts her in a different place.
That is a valid point, but I will tell you that the resource I'm referencing here made a distinction between the different Marys. It took that into account.
But the Bible does not, so therefore he cannot.
Really?
Does it mention Magdalene? I mean, you know, does it...
That one of the questions is, who were the women, right?
Okay,
Matthew,
right.
Mary Magdalene and the other Mary. Mark,
hang
Mary
on.
Magdalene...
That is Matthew 28:1. I'm going to look it up now.
Okay. Mark is Mary Magdalene, the mother of James, and Salome. That's...
And guess what Salome's other name is?
No clue.
Mary.
What? Okay. But then that distinction has been made, right?
In one of the books, yes.
Okay,
Matthew 28:1. Like one book calls Nathaniel, right. Another one says he's Nathaniel Bartholomew. Calls
even given that, you know, there could be confusion amongst the Marys, the discrepancy on the question of who were the women still stands.
Matthew 28:1 specifically says, after the Sabbath, and I'm reading from the New International Version, after the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. So it does make that distinction, yeah.
And there is no other, none of the other three books is Mary Magdalene and a second character who could be that Mary and nobody else, right? Mm-hmm. The mother of James is not mentioned in Matthew. So even if that Salome is the other Mary, there's still a discrepancy. But anyway, we're not going to hash this out in the after.
I don't have my things in front of me, but
okay. We recommend. Matt loves to do the, you know, Bible analysis stuff,
right?
And that encourage you to call back next week when Matt's on.
One other thing, if you don't mind,
this more.
It was the first thing I was going to call in for. A while back. Also wanted to point out, you had said that, you know, the first thing you look for when you get different accounts of something is to start looking for the differences, the discrepancies.
I didn't say that's the first.
The investigators, y'all were talking about a car accident.
Yeah.
Actually, investigators, the first thing they look for is how much unalike they are. because if they are too much alike, then they look for collusion first. And if let's face it, if all the Gospels were almost word for word the same, I think the biblical detractors would all be saying, well, look at this. This has to be collusion. I mean, investigators can tell you, you know, that when you get together, you know, it's like everybody got
what
together.
What you're arguing,
sure
sir,
their stories were the same.
That may be, awesome. That may be, oh my gosh, look what he's, he's got our green screen. No, you don't see the picture, do you?
No, I'm afraid
we have special effects things happening on the screen. Never mind. If the question is, are there contradictions in the Bible? Your response that, you know, contradictions are natural still leads to the answer, yes, there are contradictions in the Bible.
Discrepancies are natural.
Okay, discrepancies.
Contradictions and discrepancies are not the same thing.
But again, we're talking about not minor differences
between... Whereas another disciple just getting out of the boat and pulling it in and walking up a minute later may have seen one.
So no disagreements, no discrepancies between any of the books of the Bible means anything. That's your argument. We can just throw it all out and not take it seriously and not raise an eyebrow thinking, maybe something's up here, because that sort of thing is perfectly reasonable.
Well, let me answer that before you go on.
I'm sorry?
Let me answer that before you go on.
All right.
You can download from a site on the internet a list of 800... so-called contradictions.
Yeah.
Actually, a little bit more than 800.
Yeah.
After all my study, there's only five that don't have a good answer. All the rest can be explained just by common sense answers.
You think so?
I would not use the word think. I would say after 20 years of the research, I could sit down with you and go through every single one with you if you like sometime.
All right, well, this is not going to be that time, but...
I know.
All right, well, again, we encourage you to call in and talk to Matt if you'd like to go into this on the air.
Oh, that's great. I love talking to Matt.
He'd love that.
He's a genius.
He's a genius, and he decided not to be a Christian. Interesting.
Well, that doesn't, you know, that not all geniuses are Christians or non-Christians, you know. You can be extremely... smart and still not believe the same things. If everybody believed the same thing, then all scientists would agree on everything.
Well, okay. Fair
right.
enough. That's fair enough, but you know, it would depend. What matters are the reasons for the disagreements.
And I think you guys are intelligent too. I mean, the very fact that you question these things proves intelligence. You know, I think there's a huge difference, though, between blind faith and informed faith. I have faith, but it's an informed faith.
Yeah.
My faith is based on what seems to be credible information after a long time of study.
And, I don't want to keep going on this. Do we have anybody else on the line?
We do. Sorry
about that. I didn't want to take a bunch of time. We were off the air already.
I'm sure Matt would be happy to discuss this with you.
Yep.
Well, that's great.
Thanks for calling.
And, hey, guys, I really do have a lot of respect for you, and I really am glad about what you're doing.
Well, thank you. We appreciate
that. There's no sarcasm there. I've said that before.
Okay.
So, you know, what you're doing is a service. You know, it makes us all stop and look at our beliefs and realize that we have to believe it for reasons.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay, bye.
Who we got?
What?
David and Austin.
Line 2? Line one. No, that was the last guy.
Oh, okay.
Just answer one, and we'll find out who it is. Hello?
Okay. Hey, who are you?
Speak up if you're online. Say your name if you're online.
Hello?
Hello,
what's your name?
Get Rational Gen on camera.
Why?
I want to issue an open challenge to her to a debate. Rational Gen, where are you?
Give it a second.
You want to do this?
We're hungry.
No,
we don't have time for a big debate.
Yeah,
we're not
a debate right now. But you know what?
Jen, I am going to spank your ass, girl. I am going to beat your ass into the ground.
Okay.
You are going to...
Okay. You know what?
He can't see. How can he see her?
Russell is in charge of the debate committee, so here's the guy you need to talk to. You want to have a debate?
A formal debate. Then whoa, what the heck is happening to my
talk? Head? Yeah, we're having some weird cameras.
How could he even see?
You want to have a debate? Oh, talk to Russell.
Oh, that's
and
still
we'll
going?
Set it up, and I'll be happy to hand you your ass publicly.
Is this a WWF?
Are we sure that was in fact the guy and not just some crank?
Are you sure that he wasn't just talking dirty to you?
Okay.
Oh. Wow.
Well, I don't want to set up a debate with a kook. I mean, you know, my
we could just we could just have a debate. Somebody else could debate him on whether Jen is all that.
Jen is all that. I'll take the affirmative.
Well, it sounds like he wants to
okay,
take the affirmative.
I think.
Are we done?
All right. Well, I'm going to take the guy on line three because he was on the longest. Okay. And then everybody else, you're SOL. Hey, are you there?
Hello?
Hi.
Yeah, that's you.
Do you okay. I'm Ken.
Hi, Ken. What can we do for you?
Well, I just want to, you know, this is my first time calling ever.
Yeah.
Okay. So I guess I just wanted to just try it out. So I just have to call some other time.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
So, I guess I don't have a whole lot to say right now because it's kind of a short time, but I just wanted to just try it out. Just call. I'll just call next week.
Okay. Well, thanks for calling. The number worked. Bye. Bye, everyone in the chat room.
That was fun.
Golga.
I don't think we got some Muhammads in there, though.
Oh, that's all right. It's not. Why